and maritime safety standards.
Basically, a checklist. Hindi tayo nakakatupad dun sa iba. And the attitude in the past was just to put the document, some documentary studies, and
yes,
that's what I was telling them. So, tama, you can. Like yung mga technical, yung mga machinery, ganyan, that can't be fixed by a document. So, I think they've changed their approach now to the accreditation. And I think we'll be all right.
The president also vows to discuss with European leaders the Philippines' bid to extend the country's privileged access to the European market. This amid calls by some European lawmakers for his administration to immediately address concerns on the human rights situation under the previous administration, which would determine whether the country will continue with its generalized scheme of preferences status with the EU in the next few years when it expires in 2023. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News, Brussels, Belgium.
U.S. government sanctions against controversial Filipino religious leader Pastor Apollo Quiboloy are welcomed by a former member of his Kingdom of Jesus Christ Church. Our North America correspondent Steve Angeles tells us some U.S.-based victims of Quiboloy's alleged abuses are frustrated over their long wait for justice.
It's been nearly 3 years since the U.S. government first indicted Philippine-based Pastor Apollo Quiboloy for an alleged charity scam. Since the January 2020 raid on his Los Angeles headquarters, he had since been accused of sex trafficking and placed on the FBI's most wanted list. On Friday, to mark International Anti-Corruption and International Human Rights Day, the U.S. Treasury Department issued sanctions on 40 individuals and entities in 9 countries, including Quiboloy. In its press release, the Treasury Department cited the 2021 indictment accusing Quiboloy of sex trafficking. U.S.-based former Kingdom of Jesus Christ member Arlene Caminong Stone, who has become a vocal leader against the church, welcomes this latest development.
My initial reaction, I was shocked too. But at the same time, I was really happy because, you know, to me, that's the, you know, that's the light under the tunnel. So I believe that, you know, we are in the right track.
Stone had been a part of the church as a teenager, eventually working for Quiboloy. While she says she personally did not experience any form of abuse, she had witnessed others being victimized. For the past year, she has been vocal about the church's inner workings, echoing the Justice Department's charges. The U.S. Justice Department has not indicated if and when Quiboloy would be extradited from the Philippines to the U.S. to face his charges. And Stone says some former church members have become frustrated with the wait.
I feel bad for the people who are involved in this, who are just starting their life and they cannot proceed with their life because of what's going on. You know, the waiting period is the hardest part, I guess. But I also know that, you know, we have due process, and I am very confident with our justice system here in the U.S.
As Stone and the alleged victims wait for more movement in the case, she has taken to social media to advocate and find help by raising funds for ex-members across the world.
So, and I know when that happened, there's going to be more people that would needed help, and I would like to be ready when that happened. Just a little financial support so that they can, you know, from the, just establish their life here. Because I want them to have at least a decent start. That's what I desire for them.
Under Executive Order 13818, signed in December of 2017 by former President Donald Trump, the U.S. government would freeze assets of persons and entities found to have violated human rights. However, Quiboloy's attorneys in the U.S. and Philippines said in a press conference aired on Quiboloy's SMNI News that they won't lose sleep over the sanctions, and that by sanctioning Quiboloy, the U.S. had already declared him guilty without proper due process. Attorney Michael J. Green also says there will be no plans to combat the sanctions. In the meantime, the Kingdom of Jesus Christ U.S.-based churches continue to operate with members attending regular activities as they have since the first indictment. The trial has been scheduled for March of 2024. While Stone is not one of the plaintiffs, she is waiting to see if U.S. prosecutors will call upon her as a witness to testify. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Los Angeles.
Filipino preacher Apollo Quiboloy denies the U.S. government's accusation he is a human rights abuser and claims he has been publicly judged before a trial in America could even commence. But Quiboloy considers it a badge of honor to be in the center of controversy against what he calls the most powerful nation on earth. Mike Navallo reports.
It didn't take long before Kingdom of Jesus Christ founder Pastor Apollo Quiboloy reacted to the U.S. Treasury Department's move to slap him with financial sanctions due to alleged human rights abuses. In a report on SMNI News Channel, the media network he owns, Quiboloy was shown addressing his church members on Saturday night, the same day news broke out about the sanctions. Denying he is a human rights abuser, Quiboloy said it's his human rights that have been abused. He claimed he was already deemed guilty, tarred and feathered in the face of the world before even going to trial. He compared himself to Jesus Christ, who was accused, suffered, pilloried, beaten, and crucified on the cross. Quiboloy is facing allegations of raping girls who served as his pastorals or personal assistants who were as young as 11 years old. He is also accused of physical abuse. He was indicted by U.S. prosecutors in November 2021 for sex trafficking and cash smuggling charges. He was placed on the U.S. Federal Bureau of Investigation's Most Wanted list in February this year. In a separate development, the U.S. Treasury Department blocked his assets and prevented it from being transferred. Making contributions to him or receiving funds for and from him are also not allowed. But for Quiboloy, it's a badge of honor for him to be in the center of the controversy against the most powerful nation on earth. He likened himself to his Lord, who called him for standing for his word, for standing for righteousness. He said he is willing to lay down his life any time of the day. Justice Secretary Crispin Rimulya on Monday said the Justice Department has yet to receive any information about the sanctions imposed by the U.S. Treasury Department. Neither have they received any request for extradition of Quiboloy so that he can be brought to the U.S. to face criminal charges.
We're waiting by the sidelines kung ano ang magiging action nila. We're looking at the cases to be filed. We're waiting for things to happen on our end. Kaya sa atin naman kasi we have a treaty with them. We have an extradition treaty. And we have to abide by the terms of and conditions of our agreements. Hindi naman ito mabilis eh. Marami pang mangyayari dito. They still have to file the necessary cases. Inuna lang nila yata itong freezing of the assets. So wait and see lang tayo.
Rimulya adds he has not seen the petition for review or the appeal of the junking by Davao prosecutors of the rape, trafficking, physical and child abuse complaints against Quiboloy in June 2020. But Quiboloy's lawyers are confident the sanctions and the extradition will go nowhere.
We are very confident that if all these legal processes are followed, ay maididepensahan po namin na hindi nararapat na i-extradite si Pastor Apollo Quiboloy. 2024 pa po nilitisin si Pastor ay meron ng sanctions. So kaya nga sabi namin, at pati nga po yung mga American lawyers namin, sabi nila, this is outrageous. This is embarrassing. Nahihiya sila para sa pamahalaan nila because nawalan po ng due process.
Although the Treasury Department sanctions are different from the prosecution of the criminal charges, which is the basis for Quiboloy's extradition, his lawyer believes the two cannot be discussed separately.
How can you separate one from the other? It's inconceivable. Parang sinasabi niyo yung U.S. Treasury Department, hindi saklaw ng saligang batas ng Amerika. Kalokohan pong malaki ang sasabihin na magkaiba po yan. That cannot be the case.
Mike Navallo, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine President Marcos Jr. names a former mayor of his home province to replace the suspended chief of the National Irrigation Administration. The Malacañang Presidential Palace on Monday confirmed the appointment of Eduardo Guillen as the agency's new administrator. Guillen was previously the town mayor of Pidig in Ilocos Norte province. He replaces Benny Antiporda, who was given a six-month suspension in November by the ombudsman. Antiporda had been accused of misconduct by several of his staff.
Philippine Social Welfare Secretary Erwin Tulfo is set to be bypassed for a second time by the Commission on Appointments. The panel's presiding officer, Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri, says they've run out of time since Congress will begin its Christmas break on December 17th. Zubiri says Secretary Tulfo has yet to submit complete documents to clarify questions regarding his supposed U.S. citizenship and his previous libel convictions. But Zubiri clarifies the former broadcast journalist is still a member of the cabinet. The Senate president says Tulfo's confirmation hearings will continue next year. Up ahead, border clashes between Afghan and Pakistani forces kill several civilians.
More stories when The World Tonight returns.
Back on The World Tonight, the United States reaffirms its support for Ukraine's defense in its war against Russia. U.S. President Joe Biden spoke by phone Sunday with Ukrainian leader Volodymyr Zelensky and vowed to prioritize efforts to boost Ukraine's air defenses. Biden also underscored America's commitment to hold Russia accountable for its war crimes and atrocities. Zelensky thanked Biden for what he described as unprecedented U.S. defense and financial help to Ukraine. Zelensky also spoke with French President Emmanuel Macron about defense, energy, and the economy. He likewise discussed Ukraine's grain exports with Turkish leader Tayyip Erdogan. Zelensky's move to bolster diplomacy with other countries comes as heavy fighting continues in Ukraine's east and south.
Growing tensions in the Pakistan-Afghanistan border. Authorities say six Pakistani civilians and an Afghan soldier were killed in cross-border gunfire Sunday. Over a dozen others from both sides were injured. Pakistan forces accused their Afghan counterparts of indiscriminately firing at civilians at the Shaman border crossing. Pakistan's Prime Minister Shehbaz Sharif says the deaths deserve the strongest condemnation. He urged Afghanistan's interim government to ensure such an incident won't happen again.
Protests mount in Peru after the ouster of its former president. Officials say at least two people were killed Sunday as demonstrators clashed with police in the Apurimac region. Four others were injured. Protesters are demanding a general election after the impeachment and arrest of President Pedro Castillo. They insist Peru should elect a new leader instead of allowing the new president, Dina Boluarte, to serve until 2026. Boluarte has said she will ask Congress to pass a measure advancing the elections to April 2024. The Philippine telecoms regulator issues the implementing rules and regulations for the country's new SIM registration law. The rule set a fine of up to 1 million pesos for telco operators who cannot give a valid reason for refusing to register a subscriber's SIM. It also requires the deactivation of SIM cards if their users fail to register them. Users who provide fake names or information face a jail term of up to 2 years and a fine of up to 300,000 pesos. The measure was signed by President Marcos Jr. in October. It takes effect on December 27th.
Philippine power distributor Meralco formally asks South Premier Power Corporation to reimburse it for the higher cost of electricity it purchased from the spot market. This after South Premier, a subsidiary of San Miguel Corporation, canceled its supply contract with Meralco following a temporary restraining order from the Court of Appeals. Meralco's contract price with South Premier was 4 pesos and 30 centavos per kilowatt hour, while the price of electricity at the spot market ranges from 6 pesos to 8 pesos per kilowatt hour. Since the supply from South Premier stopped last December 7th, Meralco has been sourcing power from Wesem. Meralco says South Premier should pay the price difference, but did not disclose the actual amount.
Philippine shares closed flat Monday as worries persist over continued rate hikes by the U.S. Federal Reserve and the upcoming Philippine Central Bank meeting on Wednesday. This report.
Asian markets mostly under pressure at the start of a pivotal week, with key central banks around the world deciding on their last policy moves. For the year, led by the Federal Reserve, European Central Bank, including the PH Central Bank. The consensus, a downward shift in the Fed's tightening to 50 basis points, with the BSP matching it. But first, U.S. November inflation reading on tap on Tuesday. Philstocks Financial's Japet Antianco, hopeful.
We see a further slowdown in the U.S. inflation, which is going to be indicative of possibly a slowdown in the monetary tightening of the Federal Reserve. Then it's also going to be good for the market.
For today, the PSE index finished flat at 65.85. In corporate stories, first, PH Holdings is expanding its healthcare portfolio as it buys 100% of the local unit of Medical Services of America, or MSA, which provides cardiopulmonary services and equipment for an undisclosed amount. MSAPH started in the Philippines in 1978 and today works with over 50 partner hospitals and clinics nationwide. FPH, like this news channel, belonged to the Lopez Group. In other news, Globe Telecom has closed 32% of its landmark tower initiative, transferring another 750 towers to Frontier Towers for 9.5 billion pesos. In all, the Ayala-led telco giant has completed a sale and transfer of 2,251 out of 7,059 tower assets for 28 billion pesos. Globe says this gives us much leeway to cover its 2023 debt servicing requirements amid a background of rising interest rates. And Philinvest Group co-founder and chairman Emerita Mercedes Gutianun passed away. She was 94. Mercedes, or Chita, is the wife of the late Andrew Gutianun Sr., founder of Philinvest Development Corporation. Philinvest is one of the country's biggest conglomerates with interest property, banking, utilities, and infrastructure.
The Oscar buzz for Filipino actress Dolly De Leon gets louder after she wins the Best Supporting Performance Prize at the Los Angeles Film Critics Association Awards. De Leon was recognized for her work on the film Triangle of Sadness, in which she portrays a luxury yacht worker who takes charge of rich passengers after they're stranded on an island. She shares the award with Vietnamese-American actor Ke Huy Quan, who won it for his performance in Everything Everywhere All at Once. De Leon has been getting strong Hollywood award season buzz, a first for a Filipino talent in the highly competitive industry. Triangle of Sadness won the Palme d'Or at the Cannes Film Festival.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Jean-François Paul de Gondi. "Nothing indicates the soundness of a man's judgment so much as knowing how to choose between two disadvantages."
And that is The World Tonight, the 12th of December, 2022. I'm Vivian Gulia.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!